we're going through this fun little series called Living in a Mixed Up World. This is a world that we live in. It is mixed up. It is crazy. It is insane. It is completely backwards at times. We lived in mixed up families where we have different religions in one family, or a spouse who's a Christian and a spouse who is not, or whatever's going on. We lived in mixed up neighborhoods. We worked at mixed up jobs where people get promoted that don't deserve it, and those who do deserve it don't. And it just keeps going. And we're going to find that as we continue through Esther, it is going to seem like a chapter from our own life has been written. That's what it's going to seem like at some point or another. And we're learning through the book of Esther survival tips, okay, ways that we can try to survive this mixed up world. And when we're done with Esther, we're going to go to the book of Acts chapter 12 and continue where we left off at Acts and learn how to thrive working for God's kingdom in this mixed up world. So we're going to go from surviving to thriving in that part of Acts starting at chapter 12. So we have survival tips. And we're kind of, each time we have a sermon, we have a survival tip. And last week, we had the great privilege of doing a choose your own sermon adventure. For those that were here last week, that's where we actually had questions on the screen. And in the questions were actually did ways of going for the sermon. I had six sermons that were written, and the people picked what combination of those six sermons they got to hear. So we had questions, do you want to hear about this or hear about this? And whatever people picked, then we went that route. And then we had more questions that split. And then we went that route. And then more questions that split and went that route. And we had a chance for two different survival tips, and one of which got picked last week by the congregation by via the path that they chose. So it was quite exciting and a really fun adventure. So here's our survival tips as of this point. We learned from the beginning of the book of Esther, survival tip number one, that which is legal is not always moral. Therefore, we are to submit to a triad of authority. So what is legal is not always moral. And we looked at the triad of authority, the authority of the home, the authority of government, and then the authority of God being the top authority. So those were the three authorities that we looked at. So whenever something's happening in the home that you are thinking you shouldn't be submitting to, well, then you look, is it legal? And if just because it's legal doesn't mean that it's moral and that God is our ultimate submission of authority that we are to submit to. Tip number two that we looked at was that we are to be people of confession, repentance, and forgiveness, being initiators of this process. Xerxes did not, or King Ahasuerus did not confess his sin to his wife Vashti. He did not repent, did not ask for forgiveness, instead sought for separation of their ways and fired her as queen. And so we learned about being people of confession, repentance, and forgiveness. Tip number three, we learned about pursuing Jesus, not self-glory like King Xerxes did, and not comfort like the Jews did. And we learned then that the Jews were actually choosing not to go back to Jerusalem when God told them to. Two kings before Xerxes told them to go back to Jerusalem. Still, many Jews did not go back. Prophets Haggai and Zechariah came saying, go back, rebuild the temple, start worship. And they said, no, we like the Persian money. We don't want to worship. We like our lifestyle. We like our leisure. We're not living like Jews. We're not talking like Jews. We're not acting like Jews. We're acting and talking and living like Persians, and we like that. And so they chose not to go back to Israel and reinstitute religion there to glorifying their God and rebuilding the temple. Some Jews did. Some Jews did. But we find out that Esther and Mordecai and some of those that are in the story did not go back. They decided to stay in exile and chose not to go back. And so they pursued comfort rather than God. Then we found out that we are to choose on chip tip number four, purity over compromise. Esther chose compromise to not act like a Jew, not eat like a Jew. She chose not to follow dietary laws. She chose to listen to her cousin Mordecai, who said, don't let them know you're a Jew. Keep it all secret. Don't act, don't behave, don't do whatever. You're about to sleep with a Gentile king. It's not your husband. Do it to the best of your ability and make him go, ooh, baby, and maybe you can be queen. And wouldn't that be awesome? And so they chose compromise rather than purity. And so we learned about purity over compromise. Tip number five, we really reinvented the story Esther through a lot of this study. It's been a whole different story. It's been a lot of fun. All of it's on YouTube in case you missed it, or if you're watching online now and you're like, whoa, what did I just stumble into? You can go onto YouTube, to our YouTube channel, and be able to watch everything there. You can get the link from that from our webpage, anchorcommunitychurch.org. So life is, tip number five, life is out of your control, but not out of God's control, and that we just cannot see the end from the middle. That's what we learned in part number five. part number six, this is what we got last week, was that we got to learn to be people of truth, to seek it, learn it, and speak it. To be people of truth, and that we learned that it is a great temptation for all of us to tell a story, to tell our story in such a way that it benefits us. That when something happens, we do something wrong, we can tell the story in such a way that is to our benefit, and we need to just be honest about it, be transparent, and be about truth, not about leaving out details to benefit us or twisting details to benefit us or anything along those lines. So be people of truth. Seek it, learn it, and speak it. And since Jesus is the way and the truth and the life, we will ultimately end up at Jesus, who is the ultimate of truth. Which leaves us now to today. Isn't it great to know we just got like, I don't know, six weeks of sermons just wrapped up in like 3 minutes. Isn't that cool? Yeah, maybe for some more than others. But nonetheless, we get to kind of build on. So today we get to learn tip number seven. And tip number seven, again, like a lot of these, it'll seem simple on the surface, but once we start digging into it, the implications are a lot stronger than we might have originally realized, and that is that we need to learn to draw close to Jesus and let Jesus draw close to us. Okay, that's going to be tip number seven, to draw close to Jesus and allow Jesus to draw close to us. And I know you're going to be like, whoa, wait a minute, Jesus, this is Esther. This is Old Testament. He hasn't been born yet. They didn't know about the Messiah yet. They didn't know who he was going to be yet. How can this be about Jesus? And, well, last week we discovered that this entire story actually points to Jesus. This entire story of Esther points that direction. And so it is just amazing how Jesus is really... The whole Old Testament points to him in some way or another. When you look at the Old Testament, it all points to him. It all is about Israel and various things, and ultimately it all points to Jesus in some way or another. So we're going to see this even more today as we look at how we are to draw close to him and let him draw close to us, and how we really struggle with this. I struggle with this from time to time, and I know you guys struggle with this from time to time, because none of us are perfect, and it's going to be a battle. So we're going to see this unfold and how we struggle with this very issue. So let's start with Esther chapter 3. We're going to be looking at verse 12 to 15 to start off here, and we're going to see how Haman and Xerxes find in life a very weird comfort. Here's what has happened up to this point. Okay, King Xerxes fired his wife, the queen, for not violating Persian custom. And he wants to find a new queen. And so some young men say, let's have Bachelor Persia. Let's do that. Let's have a bachelor. We'll get the TV cameras. You can get on CBS. It'll be a great time. You can have Bachelor Persia. And so he thought that was a great idea. They went to all the different colleges and sororities and got all the hot young virgins they can find, brought them in, Esther included. And whoever slept with him and pleased him the most in bed was to be the queen. That was the goal. Whoever could be the best in bed is going to be queen. Esther won because she saw it, a special little secret, and saw it to one of his helpers and says, how can I please him? What can I bring to bed with me that will be the most pleasing to him? And she took that advice and won. And so now Esther is queen. And meanwhile, there was a plot to assassinate the king. Esther found out through her cousin Mordecai about this plot because Mordecai heard it by the water cooler about the plot to assassinate the king. So he tells Esther, Esther tells the king. The king does investigation, finds out to be true, and then finds the people who were going to kill him and had them killed, and then celebrated Haman for it and raised him up and gave him a promotion, not Mordecai. Then Haman said, bow to me like you would saluting a general, because this is how Persian worked their bowing. It was not an act of deity. It was an act of saluting a general or a military officer, or like bowing to the Queen of England. And Mordecai refused because Mordecai was jealous and had pride and said, you know, you're an Agagite. We have a whole lineage of history going on here. And beyond that, you got promoted. I didn't get promoted. I hate you. I'm not recognizing you. I refuse to bow. And then he played the race card. Oh, by the way, I'm a Jew. And we had King Saul. King Saul didn't kill your great, 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 whatever grandpappy. And so you shouldn't even be existing, let alone promoted. Get out of here. And so because Agag was the leader of the Amalekites were supposed to be killed by Israel way back in the day. Saul didn't do it. God punished Saul by removing him as king, replaced him with David. So big, long history we learned last week. It was a lot of fun. It was academic. It hurt our brains. And so now Mordecai is not bowing. And so Haman said, I know, if you're not bowing, I want to get rid of Mordecai. But since he's a Jew, and if this is really a Jewish problem, then why not we just cut the root off at the source and get rid of all the Jews? So in a pre-Hitleristic manner, he got a big old idea, went to the king and said, let's go ahead and get rid of all the Jews. The king said, sure, why not? Sounds good. Less mouths to feed. And they wrote a letter and distributed it amongst all the nations to say that, hey, on a certain day, the Jews are going to be wiped out. And it happened to be the day of the eve of Passover that the wipeout was supposed to be taking place. That's where we left off. Now let's continue. See where we go. Starting at verse 12. The royal scribes were summoned on the 13th day of the first month, and the order was written exactly as Haman commanded. It was intended for the royal satraps, the governors of each of the provinces, and the officials of each ethnic group, and written for each province in its own script, and to each ethnic group in its own language. It was written in the name of King Ahasuerus and sealed with the royal signet ring. Letters were sent by couriers to each of the royal provinces, telling the officials to destroy, kill, and annihilate all the Jewish people, young and old, women and children, and plunder their possessions on a single day, the 13th day of Adar, the 12th month. A copy of the text issued as law throughout every province was distributed to all the people so that they might get ready for that day. The couriers left, spurred on by royal command, and the law was issued in the fortress of Susa. The king and Haman sat down to drink while the city of Susa was in confusion. So they sat down to drink while everything, I mean, think about this. They just issued an order to kill thousands of people. I don't know about you, but do you think if you had issued an order like that, even if you felt you were in the right, which it wouldn't be, but let's say you had that issue and you felt like you were in the right, wouldn't you think that the death of thousands of people might have weighed heavy on your conscience just a little bit? Don't you think just a little bit? Maybe before signing it, before giving that stamp of approval with your ring, before mailing it out, you might be like, is this really the right choice? I'm going to do it. And then with a heavy heart, with nervousness, you mail it out. I mean, have you ever felt that way about trying to buy a house? You're all nervous. You're just like, do I sign this? Okay, I know. I looked at it. I liked it. The inspector, I'm all set to go. Oh my gosh, it's just nervousing to sign your name on this little document, you know? I felt that way when I sold my house. I was like, oh, is this really going to be it? Oh man, I'm just, okay. There's things that can just fill us with lots of emotions. Haman, do what? Tuition. Yeah, okay, even going to buy tuition and filling that out. Student loans, here comes $100,000 in debt. You know, and we get freaked out. And it appears that Haman and Xerxes, they just sit down and go, let's have a couple of brewskis at the local pub. And they sit down, they clink, and they go, woo, problem solved. And they throw back a couple of beers. And it's just as interesting how they're doing an act of celebration. Meanwhile, the nation that they're supposed to be ruling was in what type of condition? Confusion. Turmoil. Everyone's going, what? I got to kill my neighbors? Their kid comes over and swims in my pool. Sure, he pees in my pool, but that doesn't mean I need to kill him. Why? Now I got to take a sword to my neighbors? I work with these guys and we do stuff together. I got to take a sword to them? You know, and it's just the whole place is in confusion. And usually when confusion exists in the nation, the leaders are supposed to do what? Provide guidance and direction and create stability. Whenever there's a lot of unrest that happens in our nation, what does our president usually do? And presidents before Obama usually do. They get involved in some way. They do a press conference. They do an announcement. They write a letter and it gets to the press. They tweet. They do whatever. Play a saxophone. They do something that allow, that goes back a little few years. Okay, they allow themselves to be able to be in the face of the public to help provide a moment of stability, hope to undo the unrest, to help to the confusion to ease. Okay, that's usually what they're trying to do. Whether it works or not can be debated and whatnot. That's not the issue. They're still attempting. Okay, that's what they're doing. Here, are they attempting? No, they're chilling out at the bar. And it frustrates people because it's like, wow, there's no guilt, there's no hesitation, no conflict, no uneasiness. They have, as far as we can tell, the emotion of peace. Okay, as far as we can tell, they have the emotion of peace. And I'll tell you right now, so many people have done so many sins because they feel that God has sanctioned it, allowed it, want them to do it because they feel peaceful about it. You know, I want to sleep with so-and-so. Well, why? Well, I feel at peace about it. So surely God is going to give it a blessing. And our sleeping together, they will come and know the Lord and we'll be able to be good Christian family afterwards. And I just feel at peace. Or, you know, they're not a Christian. Well, I know, but they're hot, and I feel at peace about this. Well, you know, you've been offered a promotion. Well, yeah, I took it. I know it means I won't see my kids anymore, but I feel at peace about it. And here's the reality of this. You will feel peaceful about something if your actions are consistent with your values. But if your values are screwed up actions will give you the emotion of peace. That's what will happen. Okay, so peace is an emotion. All emotions are a reaction to something. They are not a determinant of truth. They are just a reaction to something having existed. That's all emotions are. They're a reaction. So peace is a reaction to, I know people that will cut people out of their life and they'll just do it because they're being selfish or whatever. And they'll say, you know what? You didn't do it my way, so forget it. I don't want to talk to you again. I feel at peace about that. Well, yeah, your values say the person's not valuable and your actions agree. So you're going to feel peaceful about that. And that's not meaning that it's right and moral and it's not a sin. Okay, so here, Haman and Xerxes, also Ahasuerus, same king, Greek and Persian names. Okay, this king and his side ruler there, his little first-hand man, they are at peace because their actions and their values match. But what is it like outside of the kingdom? What's it like outside of those palace rooms where the celebration and clinking of glasses is happening? We get a contrast happening there. Okay, we got partying and then we got confusion. But let's see this confusion more personally. Like through the eyes of Mordecai, chapter 4, verse 1 says this. When Mordecai learned all that had occurred, he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth and ashes. Okay, I'm excited about this. This is good news. This is really good news. Now, I know you're saying, this is horrible. This is mourning. This is grief. This is fasting. This is a guy with heavy emotions. But this is really good news because now Mordecai is acting like a Jew. He's repenting finally. He's acting like all this time. He's like, Esther, don't tell anyone you're a Jew. Hide that you're a Jew. Act like a Persian. Eat like a Persian. Talk like a Persian. Behave like a Persian. And don't act like a Jew. Don't mention anything about Jew. Don't eat like a Jew. Just keep it all quiet. Now, after he finally laid out the Jew card last week, when we read that part of the text, now he's finally acting like a Jew. Because when Jews tore their clothes, put on sackcloth and ashes, this is what you do when you pray to God out of desperation and heartache. So though we don't have a prayer listed, this is that behavior. This is that Jewish behavior. This is Mordecai finally saying, I'm going to draw close to God. This is Mordecai finally saying, I am done drawing close to leisure. I'm done drawing close to pleasure. I'm done drawing close to money and ease and my job. And it's time for me to just put all that aside and call out to God with every coreness of my being. So he puts on sackcloth and ashes. He went into the middle of the city. So his faith is no longer private. It's public. Okay, he's no longer just a Christian in his own little bedroom or just a God follower in his own little in the bathroom as he's sitting on the throne. He can kneel before God's. He's no longer just keeping it private. Now Mordecai is public with his faith. Now he goes out to the middle of the city and he cries loudly and bitterly. He only went as far as the king's gate since the king's law prohibited anyone wearing sackcloth from entering the king's gate. So the king, knowing there's already Jews there, and sometimes they mourn like this, has already made a law saying, hey, you Jewish buzzkills, When you want to do your buzzkill moment, you keep it out there, not in here. In here is party zone. This is our zone of happiness. You can't come into our zone of happiness. You need to keep your buzzkill stuff out there. And Mordecai's always been able to come into the zone of happiness because Mordecai's been Persian boy. Well, now Mordecai has the sackcloth. He has the ashes. And he respects the king's law, which is very polite of Mordecai, even though it's the king who set out the rule to say, kill all the Jews. So he doesn't still break the law. Isn't it nice to know that it is possible to protest something and not break the law while doing it? Seems like that's a misnomer in today's society. That people think if you got to protest, you got to break the law. This is what makes it all better. But here's a type of weeping and wailing and mourning and not breaking the law, which is really nice to see that in demonstration. We'd like to see that passed on amongst other people. Nonetheless, so this law prohibited anyone from wearing sackcloth from entering the king's gate. Verse 3, there was great mourning among the Jewish people in every province where the king's command and edict came. They fasted, they wept, they lamented. Keep in mind, fasting, that is where you choose not to eat so that you can spend that time praying. You will not take that 3 minutes to push 3 minutes on high in the microwave. You spend that 3 minutes praying. And the amount of time you would spend trying to figure out how to get the food in your mouth and what tastes best with what, you would say, nope, I'm going to spend this whole time in prayer. Okay, so this is what they're doing. They're fasting, they're weeping, they're lamenting, and many lay on sackcloth and ashes. So many people are taking it right to the extreme in addition to the fasting, weeping, and lamenting, like Mordecai did. As he's fasting, weeping, and lamenting, he's also doing the sackcloth and ashes. So we have a total sign of grief and unrest in the nations of Persia and all the areas that they rule. Okay, now here's what's interesting. The grief, the emotion that they're presenting, we use the word grief, that's why I hear Mordecai's grief. What other emotions might you say are synonyms to grief? What other emotions might you say they could be feeling here that you see them demonstrating they put on sackcloth? Would you say it's happiness? No. Would you say there's anger? I don't see any signs of anger. What emotions are you seeing? Sadness. Okay. Well, let's hammer that for a moment. Sadness. Despair. Okay. Sadness and maybe even hopelessness. Okay. So sadness, despair, maybe even hopelessness. Like, God, please, you. There's nothing we can do now. You know, there could even be fear. Absolutely, there's going to be fear. There's these emotions going on. Now, I find it interesting that these exact emotions tend to be not appreciated in our culture, in American culture. We tend to have, in our country, in our culture, predominantly speaking, yes, there's exceptions, but predominantly speaking, what I tend to have noticed is that we tend to have two emotions, happy and angry. We tend to have those two. And anger is a secondary emotion. All anger, 100%, come from fear. You have fear first, then anger. So we have fear. We just don't admit we have fear. We just jump straight to anger and skip recognizing that there's fear that leads to that anger. Okay, so we tend to be a nation, as I've noticed, we get people who are either happy and they're celebrating. Like, for example, if whenever MSU beats U of M or vice versa, there's usually two things that take place at that game. There is the celebration and people being happy, or there's the anger and the riots and the looting that take place because their team lost. Is there sadness there? Not being displayed. Maybe it's being felt, but it's being repressed. It's being distracted from. It's being pushed to the side and replaced with anger. Okay, and so we tend to find that happiness and anger are our favorite emotions. Happiness because it's comfortable and it's pleasurable and we like it. And anger because it makes us look tough. But what does sadness tend to do? What does fear tend to do? What does despair tend to do when we see somebody expressing those emotions? They tend to be signs of, we would say, weakness. That's what we tend to do. And we tend to say that those, in fact, I've even heard a lot of people say those are bad emotions. These are the good emotions. And in reality, no emotions are bad or good. They're emotions. They're either pleasurable or unpleasurable. We either like them or we don't like them, but they're not bad or good. They're emotions. But when we see a kid who's crying, what do we want to do? First step is stop them from crying. Why? What if it's proper for them to cry? What if they're hurt? What if they're afraid? What if they're sad? Isn't it okay for them to cry? But we want to jump right in and go, shh, don't cry. It's going to be okay. Well, what if it's not going to be okay in reality? What if their parents are splitting? And it's going to be a devastating life from that point forward. What if it's not going? What if their pet just died? And now they're grieving and they're crying. And it's not going to be okay because it's not like their pet's going to come back unless it's a creepy horror movie. Okay, well, what if it's not going to be at that moment okay? You know, but we want to distract from those emotions. But that's how our society is kind of functioning. We don't act like Mordecai. We act like Haman and Xerxes. We act with parties, and if something doesn't go our way, we act with anger and cut the other person out or remove them or backbite them or try to remove their influence, try to threaten them so they will concede to our way, but we don't respond with sadness. We tend to view that as somehow, in fact, another way of looking at it would be this. You come into church, you've had a horrible day, horrible week, you're sad, you're upset, you're depressed, and then someone says, hey, how you doing? The response is, one word, begins with the letter F, fine. Well, what word were you thinking of? Okay, it's fine, right? People start chuckling and smiling at me. Come on. Okay, it's fine, right? Fine. Now, are you fine? No. So why say fine? Because I don't want to talk about that I'm sad. I don't want to think about it. I want to distract myself from it. I don't want to focus on it. So I'm going to say fine. Well, what does the word fine do when it's said in church? When it's not true? It does two things. One, it prevents the body of Christ from acting like the body of Christ. Because the purpose of the body of Christ is to encourage and to strengthen and to help comfort. And when you say fine, when it's not fine, you're preventing the body of Christ from doing that. And then number two, you say fine when it's not fine, you are lying, aka sin, which breaks relationships and grieves the heart of God. And you expect there to be proper worship? I mean, think about it. You just showed up to say, God, speak into my life, but I'm going to lie. Is God going to honor that? Absolutely not. Because we're not drawing close to him. We're drawing close to our emotions and our distractions. And we're drawing away from God and from the people that he's placed into our life. And so fine is not a cool answer. Unless you are actually really fine, then absolutely don't make up a problem. That's just dysfunction. Okay, that just gets all kind of weird. But if you're having a problem, absolutely admit that. But we have a tendency to want to distract. It's almost as if we have a goal in life to be happy. That's our goal. My goal is to be. Now, I'm not going to say happiness is not bad. I'm not anti-happiness. People sometimes misunderstand me when I talk about this type of a topic. I'm not saying I'm anti-happiness. Not saying that at all. Okay, I love being happy. Okay, I love laughing. I love comedians. Okay, I'm all pro happiness. If someone told me choose happy or sad, I'm gonna choose happy. Okay, if I have an option, would you like, you know, this job that'll make you happy or this job that'll make you sad? Well, I'll choose the happy job. You know, I want to be happy. So I get that. I'm just want to point out that the Bible never has happiness as the goal. It never says be happy. It never says to pursue happiness. It says to pursue joy, but joy does not mean happy. That's a misunderstanding. We think it does. We go, I got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart. You know, but it doesn't mean happy. Happiness can result sometimes from joy, but Jesus considered it joy to go to the cross. That's what the Bible says. And so he was not happy about it. In fact, he prayed as if his sweat was like blood, thick and heavy and running, and was like, God, if there's any way, take this cup from me. I don't want this. I'm not pleased. I am not happy with plan A. But Jesus called it joy, considered it joy. Why joy? Because joy means hope. Okay, joy means hope, not happy. So Jesus saw the hope in him going to the cross, considered the cross an act of hope because of the salvation that would be offered, and he went because in reality, hope is a greater motivator than happy is. But happy is never to be a goal. It's not supposed to be. It's not a biblical goal. The Greek word for happy is eudaimonia, never exists in the Bible. Aristotle used it often. So when our founding fathers founded our country and wrote out our Constitution, our Bill of Rights, and they said the pursuit of happiness, they were not, though they might have had Bible in mind, they did not have Christian doctrine in mind or any particular verse. They had Aristotle's influence in mind, the pursuit of eudaimonia, the pursuit of happiness. Okay, so we're going to have to look at this just for a little bit. I want to see how we can understand, how we can learn to grieve. I want us to get to draw close to God sometimes in our sadness. If you haven't seen it yet, here's a great movie to see. It's called Inside Out. It's a Pixar cartoon. Great show. And the Pixar cartoon is all about how much they worked so hard to remove sadness from the picture. Okay, sadness was the bad one. Here's, in fact, at one point, joy drew a circle around sadness and said, keep all sadness right here and don't ever let it leave. Okay, because they didn't want sadness. But the little girl in the cartoon needed to be sad because they were moving and she was sad. And all the parents wanted was for her to keep a smile on her face, to deny that emotion, and to say everything's fine in order to make it easier for them, because for them, sadness was uncomfortable. Happiness was the goal. Okay, and we gotta recognize differently than that. We gotta think differently than that. We gotta be more scripturally accurate than that, because we find of all the emotions that are expressed, sadness is expressed in the Bible a lot. Okay, it is in there a lot, and how to grieve and how to mourn and how to weep and how to comfort sadness. And we can't comfort it if we don't even know how to appreciate it. Okay, so let's just kind of look at this a little bit here. If we're going to be able to answer this question, why do Americans try to hide their emotions of sadness, their emotions of fear, their emotions of grief, the emotions of whatever? If they try to hide it by distracting it with doing whatever, okay, why do they try to do that? We have to kind of make it more personal as far as how we maybe have a way of distracting ourselves from it and try to hide it. So I'm going to ask some more personal questions, not for you to answer out loud, but for you to kind of ponder and to think this through. I'm going to start with a simple one and then two follow-up ones for us to kind of get this. And these are simple questions. As you are sitting in your chair right now, are you happy? And how you answer that will determine whether you want to come back again next week. It will be a strong influencer. Like, why did I come here? I am not happy about sitting here. And if I get up, people will notice, and that will make me look embarrassed and like a stupid freak. So I'm just going to sit here for a while longer. You know, are you happy at this moment? And if you're not happy, what is your goal later today to get more happy? Leaving here, we'll start. You know, whatever the case is, okay? Another way of looking at it would be this. Maybe you can finish this phrase. I'll be happy when? Fill in the blank. And if you don't know how to answer that question, maybe this one will help. Life will slow down when? Okay, usually when someone's younger, this top one, I'll be happy when I graduate. I'll be happy when I move out of my parents' house. Your parents will be too. I'll be happy when... okay, I'll be happy when, right? Younger people, that's where they can now start appreciating. They may not be able to answer yes or no. They might say sometimes, but this really gives direction now. Older people, it's this bottom one. Life will slow down when I finally retire. Life will slow down when the kids move out. Life will slow down when, and you just fill in the blank. But in reality, guess what happens? Life never slows down for people who don't know how to be slow. People tend, I've talked to so many people in retirement, and they say, I've never been so busy in all my life. I had a schedule that exhausted me, that prevented me from overcommitting myself. And once I got rid of that job, suddenly I am committed to so many things, so many places, I can't even tell if I'm coming or going. And I am more busy now than I ever was when I worked 40 to 60 or 80 hours a week. I've had so many people tell me that. And seeing some of the looks on some of your faces, some of you who have maybe been retired for a while, you're like, yeah, that is so true. I don't know what happened. It's not like I chose it. It just dumped on me. Suddenly life is so busy. And the younger people, they say, I'll be happy when, not recognizing that when they achieve that, it's still not there. Because there seems like there's still a pull for something else, that this isn't quite it. There's something more beyond, and I can't quite figure out what that is. And still, we can say, I thought I'd be happy when I moved out. I thought I'd be happy when I bought a house, but then I heard about something called mortgage. What's this utility? What are all these bills suddenly? You know, and so it's this constant problem that is there. I thought I'd be happy when, and then suddenly it's not what they thought, because they're drawing close to something that's not going to draw close back in the right way. So something's not quite working right. And I want us to see somebody's pursuit so that we can come back to Mordecai, Haman, and Xerxes and see this from a different light. So I want to just kind of switch our gears a little bit to the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 2. I know it seems odd. We've been in Esther all this time, and I don't think I've ever really exegeted a passage in the middle like this of such detail, but I'm going to do it this week because you guys sacrificed to be here, and you gathered, and we're here, so why not, right? So let's do this little bit of an excursion, okay? A little bit of an adventure. And Ecclesiastes is a depressing book, so I'm going to throw in a lot of humor here and there. And I'm telling you what, right now, the harder you laugh, the more funny I'll get. I'm just telling you that right now. Come on, that was funny all by itself, and one person chuckled. I mean, come on. So I'm going to do my best to try to keep this a little bit, at least fun, because Ecclesiastes can be very depressing. And I've recently, we went through a whole study of Ecclesiastes, and we had a lot of fun with it. So I'm going to try to take some of the greatest hits and move them in a little bit and add some new stuff. So Solomon does a pursuit of pleasure. That's what he's doing in chapter 2. He starts talking about how, in verse 1, he says, I decide I'm going to pursue pleasure. I want to find out, is there meaning in life in being happy? Is happy really the goal here? Is it kind of, he doesn't use the word happy because happy doesn't occur. He uses the word pleasure. Okay, I want to be comfortable. I want to have pleasure in my life. My goal is to be pleasurable, to be comfortable, to find pleasure. And he's trying to find it. And repeatedly, he's going to find out that everything he's pursuing is hebel. That's the Hebrew word, hebel. And it usually gets translated futile in our text. And really what it ends up meaning is futile is this worthless, it's ineffective, completely a waste of time type. It just isn't there. Okay, it's a sense of worthlessness to it. It's a very heavy word. But futile works. I like futile. It's very Star Trek-y. Right? It's like the Borg. Resistance is futile. It's a waste of your efforts. It is just, it's hopeless, okay? It's just, you cannot resist. It's that type of a thing. Okay, so he goes off about what he's pursuing. He gives a good little list here. So let's look through this list in Ephesians chapter 2. So as he goes through, he ends up saying that I end up pursuing laughter in verse 2. I end up pursuing laughter. Here's a great long list here. I thought I broke this up. So he says, I pursued laughter, verse 2. I understand the pursuit of laughter. If my kids are sad and crying, I try to make them laugh. Right? That's why I go, tickle bug, tickle bugs, and my Darby goes, ooh. She still wants to cry, but she might laugh for a moment. But I mean, how many of you, when you're just feeling down, you might want a really good comedian? Or a good comedy, good romantic comedy, you know? And so maybe you just try to find a John Penney CD, or you look for Sinbad on television, or you just try to find a good comedian. And I love a good comedian. I'll be honest with you. I love a good comedian. In fact, if a comedian can make me feel like I'm going to throw up, they have skill. Okay, that seems to be the goal. If I can go, ow, oh, I'm going to barf, oh, I'm going to barf, hit pause, praise God, it's a DVD. If this was real life, I'd be dead, you know? You know, that's that issue there. We love to laugh. But what Solomon ends up saying at the end of verse 2 is that it ends up accomplishing nothing. It's futile. It's hebel. In the end, after laughter, as good as it is, as fun as it is, after laughter, I still have these problems. This laughter did not provide for me the solution. It did not change the situation. I'm just as sad after as I am before. Sure, I wasn't during. But in the end, it didn't really accomplish anything. So he said it was futile. The problems of life still linger. And then he tries then in verse 3, he said, you know, I'll try wine. Wine and folly. That sounds good. I'll ponder alcohol. Surely alcohol is the answer. So he takes his suits, he sells them all, takes the money, buys NASCAR t-shirts, and he decides to go to Ferris State University and join a frat. And he decides he realizes that, hey, we all have drinking problems. We got two hands and one mouth. So let's get a hat where we can put both our beers on with really long straws. That way we could drink two beers at one time with one suck of our mouth, and we'll have our hands free to still play Diablo 3 on our PS2. Okay, we can still be able to, this is the answer. Surely this is the way that we can be here. And so we can just, and he says, no. No, and he's not talking about debauchery here. He ends up saying the phrase that he was guided with his wisdom. In other words, he wasn't trying for debauchery. He wasn't trying for drunkenness. It wasn't about, you know, passing out, waking up going, oh, my head, what happened yesterday? It wasn't about that. It was about just wine and partying and whatnot. And is this going to take away the pain? Is this going to allow me to? Because Solomon, when he's writing Ecclesiastes, he's writing it like a grandpa. Okay, he's already lived out a lot of his life. He's getting ready to die, and he's looking back, and he is seeing a life and a legacy loss. He is seeing all the mistakes he made, how he squandered the kingdom, how God gave him some great gifts, some great wisdom, and he used it for himself. He used it for selfish purposes, and he's looking back going, what in the end have I gained? What in the end was the point of all that mess? And so he's looking at all the wine and all the folly and craziness that he went through, and still, in the end, it didn't work. So he says, I tried projects, verses 4 through 6. As we all know, projects around the house provide meaning and purpose and satisfaction to life until they go undone and they linger. And they linger, and the cost to do it, because then you have to find out you got to have somebody else do it, ends up coming up, and bills start rising up, and suddenly it's not so fun anymore. Okay, so some of us have tried gardening, or tried maybe gardening. Maybe we tried, you know, doing some gardening when we found out that there's something called worms and pests. Okay, maybe we tried many other different things. We just are like, man, what is going on? Maybe some people have thought that, I know. He goes on, leisure, music, money, and women. So within all of this, he even talks about animals. And how many people have tried finding satisfaction and happiness and comfort in life with a pet? You know, you get the lady who says, I know, 100 cats, that'll do it. That'll provide my life meaning. I'll just get myself a dozen cats. I'll be the cat lady of the neighborhood. Or maybe a dog. Maybe we can get a dog. And here's the thing. I'm going to share a little glimpse of wisdom with you guys, someone who's had several pets in his life. Every time you get a pet, what you are really purchasing is a small disaster. Just hasn't happened yet. Because one day, I mean that on the other end of my grief, okay? I mean that on the other end of my grief. Because that pet will one day die. Or you will have to have the pet put down because the pet is suffering too great, or whatever the case may be. Or the pet will get run over, will get lost and never come back, whatever. What you are purchasing is a small little disaster. And so you say, this will provide meaning for my life. When in the end, it's going to bring you a disaster at some point or another. And not saying pets are bad. Pets are fun. Pets are good, as long as you're not allergic. Okay, but I'm just saying, you know, pets are fine. Just keep in mind, it is not going to solve your problem. Okay, it's not, it might give you problems. It is not going to solve your problem. And understand, it might give temporary relief of little things here and there. Well, at least there's life in the house. And there are parents that when their children move out, they end up feeling like their house is too quiet. And rather than trying to get through that and to embrace the emotions of that and to draw close to God through that, instead they distract with a pet. Okay, and then ends up just not working. Not like they thought, because there's still that lingering, still something else that's going on beyond. And so Solomon's like, I'm trying leisure, I'm trying animals, I'm trying gardening, I'm trying music. He's like, I paid for a band to follow me around and play my theme song 24/7. Everywhere I go, it's a musical. I don't know about you, that sounds pretty cool. I would love it if my life became a musical. You know, but he's like, I follow the band because I love music. Surely music will give me comfort. Music will give me satisfaction. Music will give my life meaning. If I can walk through, break into song whenever I want, and have a band playing. And we have that all over. Even the most poor people in our society today have this ability now. You can tell because they got these little free phones, and they got earplugs that go into them, into the ear. I see them over the bus station. They're homeless, but they got a phone with the earbuds, and they're singing. Because apparently they want to share their music with the rest of the world. And not really the music, because you can't hear the music, you just hear them singing. Unless, of course, they got their own phone, which has a speaker to it, and they decide to go ahead and play that all over the bus station. Okay, and so they're going through school, or they're in whatever, and they're just, and they're singing, and security tells them, turn that down. They say, no, I will not turn it down. It is my music, and I have the freedom of speech. And they go off with a big old tyrant. And see, they're walking around with their own personal band, okay, and they're going off. And so they're trying what Solomon tried, and Solomon kept going. He's like, you know, he's like, money will work. I'll even have myself my own chef. And I thought to myself, ooh, wouldn't it be great to have your own chef? How many of you would like that? You know, and some of you are like, I thought I would like it. That's why I got married, but she quit cooking. But, you know, you know, but wouldn't it be great to have, I'm telling you what, your pastor would love to have his own chef, a P.F. Chang's in my basement. Oh, yeah, baby, I would love that, right? Just my own personal P.F. Chang's, the chef that can whip up whatever I'd like, whenever I'd like. Oh, yeah, that would be nice. My wife would be happy with that, too. Okay, so maybe you can put that on the budget for next year. Pastoral package includes a P.F. Chang's. That sounds good to me. Sign me up. You know, that's what Solomon's doing. He's trying to figure out how can he have it all. He even goes to women. He ends up having himself 700 wives, 300 concubines. We're talking 1,000 women that are in his harem. At his disposal, at his whim, whenever he wants. So he could think to himself, what do I feel like today? Maybe I want something old. Maybe I want something young. Maybe I want something fat. Maybe I want something skinny. Maybe I want a brunette, a blonde, any combination of the group, experienced, virgin, I don't know. And he's just trying to get whatever, however, whenever he wants. And he tries to fill himself in with that. And he says, maybe that will make me happy if I can have all the crazy pleasurable ideas in my mind satisfied. I can go 50 shades of whatever, and I can just have a grand old time. And that's just what he thinks will do it. And it doesn't work. He says it's futile. And people do that today too, by the way. How many men have within their hard drives, and because of the internet, their harem at their exposure, at their disposal, right? Where they have just 100, whatever, 200,000 women that they could have whatever they want. They just type it up. I want to see this. I want to see this doing this. And they can just do whatever with pornography, and they got their own mental harem going on. We have, and in our poorest of society, people who are living like the kings of old. I mean, just think about that. Okay, whether poor or wealthy, they have the same issues at play. And people say, well, if I had money, surely that will make things better, because then I could hire a band. But the music's not the answer. Well, if I could hire Shirley, then I could have better projects, but the projects aren't the answer. Surely I could have a better house, but the house isn't the answer. I could be able to have and sleep with whoever I want, however, yeah, so do people that are poor and homeless, and just still isn't the answer. Well, then I could have, you know, the leisure of whatever I could imagine. Well, so do the others, and that you could see in both sides, rich and poor, neither one are happy. neither one are really having a meaningful, purposeful life in the way that is satisfying because they're drawing close to a distraction. That's what they're doing. They're acting like Haman and Xerxes, whether rich or poor. They're drawing close to a distraction. So what are you drawing close to? Do you draw close to comfort? Do you try, whenever you're feeling sad, to distract it with what? Eating? Do you try to distract yourself with a movie? Try to distract yourself with a video game? Try to distract yourself with a book? I mean, what is it you draw close to when tragedy strikes your life? What you tend to find your satisfaction, your significance, your comfort, your ease from all the emotions of life. When tragedy hits, what do you just say? Man, I just want to just shut out the world, get into my living room, pop on a show, and prop my feet up on my nice chair, and I just want to kick back, and I want to just drown, just windows closed, nobody bothering me. Then I will be satisfied. Then I can have comfort in my life. See, what you're doing is you're drawing close to isolation. See, what is it you draw close to when tragedy hits your life? Whatever you answer those first questions, I will be happy when, life will slow down when, those tend to be what we try to draw close to. That's the temptation. That's what we try to draw close to. It's, in a sense, a type of idolatry. We're not drawing close to God, we're drawing close to something else. What idolatry does, it takes something that's totally good in and of itself, and then it twists it and perverts it. That's what idolatry does. It takes sex, which God created and is good, and it perverts it. It takes gardening, which is good, God created it, and it perverts it. It takes houses, which is good, and perverts it. It takes jobs, which are good, and perverts it. It takes all these things. That's what idolatry does. And then the actions of going back to it and drawing close to it over and over again is the act of worship. Gluttony, eating, is an act of worship. What are they worshiping? They're worshiping the God of comfort, and eating is how they get there. We all worship something or someone. Why do people keep going back to destructive relationships over and over and over again? They just can't seem to find the one, and they don't understand how and why. And why is it everything keeps getting so bad in their relationships and they just can't quite figure it out? It's because you're drawing close to a relationship and the dating is your act of worship. You're not drawing close to Jesus. That's what's happening. And so you're compromising your standards over who it is you're dating. That's what happens over and over again. What is it you draw close to? And when tragedy, I've seen people when tragedy strikes, they'll end up saying, I did a really stupid thing. I called up my ex. And we went out and we had another fling. You know, I've seen that happen so many times in people's lives because they draw close to a relationship in times of tragedy. So what is it you draw close to? Solomon pursued a lot. Wouldn't you agree? His results and conclusion was that it was useless and futile and Hebel. But here's what's interesting, though. Look at these pursuits that he has there. In themselves, each of these are overall good thing. Right? In and of themselves, there's nothing wrong with laughter, nothing wrong with wine, nothing wrong with projects, nothing wrong with leisure or music or money, and there's nothing wrong with women, nothing wrong with men, okay, nothing wrong with children, right? These are in themselves predominantly, overall, they're good things in themselves. But why was he pursuing them? For what purpose? Himself. He did it for himself. Not because he was worshiping God, not because he loved God and wanted to love God through, not because he wanted to honor God with, he did it for himself, to himself, for himself, with himself. It was all for him. Okay, that was his whole thing. He was trying to draw close, in a sense, to himself rather than to God. My daughter, she's 4 years old. She turns 5 this Christmas. She was born on December 22nd, so we get lots of fun come Christmas time. She has this thing. She is a daddy's girl like you could ever imagine. Okay, I mean, hyper, super daddy's girl, and I rather find it kind of fun. It's really neat. She does all she can to be right next to me, especially when a situation's uncomfortable. When we got to our family gathering yesterday, we went to over to the Detroit area and over into like the Rochester specifically. And so we're in that general side of the state. And when we got in, there's all these strangers, as family gatherings usually have. Okay, so we see all these strangers. And what she does is she just kind of sits or stands real close. She wraps her arms around my leg. And she just holds on, and she just nuzzles her head in, and then she looks, and she sees everybody from that perspective, and she just wants to be so close. When she wakes up in the morning, sometimes she'll wake up at, 5 or even 6 a.m. She's a morning girl. I'm a morning guy myself. I'm usually waking up about that time, too. I'm just trying to convince my body that it's time to get up. And so my mind's going, woohoo! My body's going, shut up! And so I lay in bed for a little bit trying to figure out how to get coordinated. And usually I end up hearing the sound of a door opening. And then I hear, and then I see my door handle begin to move, and the door begins to open, and there's this shadow. And I know it's my daughter because the hair is going, okay? And so she's climbing up onto the bed, and first thing she does is she comes right up on top of me, and then she just belly flops on, okay, on top of me, and she snuggles in close, and she says, Daddy, it's time to get up. I want to play a game on a phone, and I want you to watch me play. And she'll grab my hand and start pulling, and she'll grab my finger and pull. In fact, even just this morning, my son started doing this now. I got up this morning. He had already gotten up. He was upstairs watching TV, and he saw me, and I'm like, dude, what's going on? And he said, ah, and he patted the chair and wanted me to sit down. I sat down, and he climbed up on my lap and just snuggled in real close. See, these are kids who want to be close to their dad. That's their goal right now, is to be close to their daddy. You see where I'm going with this? God is our Father. And we should have it as our desire to be as close to Him as often as we can, and to have Him close to us. That should be our pursuit, to be as close as we can to our dad, to our Heavenly Father, to be as close as we can and to draw Him close to us, to grab a hold of His hand and pull and say, I want you to come with me, and I want to be with you, and I don't want to be apart. This is what Mordecai is finally starting to do. Mordecai finally, as he experiences his grief, rather than distract it, rather than say, and Esther later, she says, send him stuff. She tries to say, hey, you're acting Jewish, quit it. Here's some clothes. And she has her servant send him really good clothes. We'll see this all next week. She says, here's some clothes. Wear these instead. And she tries to distract the issue. And Mordecai rejects. And he says, I need to draw close to God. I need to be face to face with this grief. I need to work myself through it. And I need to seek the face of God. I need to grab His hand because He's been distant too far in another room, in another house. I need to grab His hand, and I need Him close, and I need to draw close to Him like I probably should have been doing from the beginning. And Mordecai is drawing close. So this afternoon, will you draw close to God? Will you draw close to Jesus and let Him draw close to you? And if you've been distant all this time, if you've been feeling like, man, I just feel distant, I don't know why, I pray, but it feels like my words not higher than the ceiling and all these things you're having going on, and you're like, I feel like we have a cell phone that's just call failed. God's just not involved. What is it going to take before you begin to realize that you're the one that has to begin to make the changes? It's not about trying to convince God to change and to act in some different way. When is it going to realize that you need to start drawing close to Him? What is it going to take to shake you from that? It might end up being a tragedy. I hope not. I hope we can draw close before tragedy strikes. It doesn't prevent the tragedy, but it makes the tragedy more bearable. But what will it take for you to draw close? I have a closing word of prayer.